Anxiety is a normal part of life. You might feel anxious when you have a big test or a meeting with your boss, or when you don't have enough money to pay the bills in your bank account. But when anxiety goes beyond just a temporary fear or worry, when it starts to impact your life, your work, your relationships, or even your health, that's when it becomes a serious concern. If you have anxiety, you feel it. The list of physical issues sounds like the end of a Cialis ad.
If you're taking anxiety, symptoms may include chest pain, muscle tension, headaches, stomach aches, nausea, heart palpitations, restlessness, dizziness, problem sleeping, hot flashes, chills, a whole bunch of other things, and death. Haha, I'm just kidding about that last one.
Chronic anxiety can be really bad for your long-term health, too. It's been linked to things like heart attacks and suppressed immune system. And that doesn't even address what's going on in your head. Anxiety disorders often have cognitive distortions. Cognitive distortions are irrational thoughts or beliefs about ourselves or the world around us. Basically, it's a fancy word for worries. Examples of this might include things like all or nothing thinking.
If I don't get done everything on my to-do list today, I'm gonna be a total failure.
And catastrophizing.
Oh no, I can't believe I made a typo in that email. They must think I'm an idiot.
These cognitive distortions can have serious impacts on behavior as well, affecting a person's day-to-day life, how they interact with friends, or how they manage their job. Without treatment, anxiety symptoms tend to become more severe and frequent over time. But don't fret, help is out there. Contrary to popular belief, an anxiety disorder isn't something you can just snap out of or ignore. It also isn't a sign of personal weakness or someone who's unstable. Anxiety disorders can affect anyone. This stigma against anxiety disorders keeps people from seeking help. Only 1/3 of people suffering from anxiety get treatment, and people who believe that anxiety is a choice are even less likely to get help when they actually need it. So, how do anxiety disorders come about, and who's at risk? Well, there's a popular way of thinking about anxiety called the threshold model. Imagine for a moment a graph with a normal distribution curve. The y-axis is the number of people in your population, and the x-axis is the predisposition to anxiety. In the general American population, about 20% of people have a current anxiety disorder. That means that people whose anxiety level crosses the threshold in this upper 20% will likely experience an anxiety disorder. This threshold can also change based on how you change the population. For example, anxiety seems somewhat hereditary. So, if the population is people who have parents with anxiety disorders, that threshold goes up to 30%. Or if the population is individuals who have experienced a traumatic event, such as mass violence, that threshold goes up to 67%. As you can see, there's a lot of factors that can change the threshold. So, on an individual basis, depending on genetic predisposition, environment, and life experiences, the threshold will change. Okay, so let's say you think you might have anxiety, and you'd like to get some help. Now what? The first step is setting up a meeting with a psychiatrist, psychologist, or counselor. You can discuss your thoughts and symptoms with them, and they'll determine your diagnosis. Then they'll help you understand it and work with you on coping with your anxiety. There are a lot of ways to treat anxiety. Typically, the combination of medication and talk therapy is considered the most effective treatment. Allie talked about different medications, but today I'm focusing on the therapy side of things. Honestly, there's a lot of different therapies that could be helpful for treating anxiety. But there is one that stands head and shoulders above the rest with more than 30 years of compelling empirical data. Cognitive Behavioral Therapy, or CBT. CBT focuses on what and how a person thinks or acts, more than why a person thinks or acts that way. To boil it all down, CBT has two goals. First, there's cognitive restructuring, which involves the therapist and client working together to change thinking patterns. For example, treatment may focus on changing cognitive distortions. If the person is able to recognize irrational thoughts and change them, they will be more able to reduce their anxiety in the future. The second goal is behavioral activation, which involves clients learning to overcome obstacles to participate in enjoyable activities. For example, exposure therapy involves exposing a person to their fear without any actual danger. If a person is scared of snakes, for example, you might have a non-venomous snake in an enclosed tank across the room. The therapist then helps the client through what they're feeling. Eventually, when they become desensitized to the fear and feel more comfortable, the therapist moves the tank a little closer until the client's anxiety returns, and then they repeat the process. But how effective is this? Well, for specific phobias like fear of sharks or string beans, individuals can see an 80% improvement in symptoms with as little as 2 to 9 hours of cognitive behavioral treatment. In panic disorder, patients see about 60 to 93% improvement in symptoms, depending on their length of therapy. Patients with social anxiety disorder and most forms of PTSD also see significant long-term improvement when using exposure and social skills training. Overall, CBT's effectiveness is huge. At home, on your own, there are a lot of coping skills that help reduce anxiety, mostly lots of things that are good for your self-care. These include building strong relationships, getting lots of sleep, exercise, eating well, doing fun activities, and meditation. If you'd like to try reducing your anxiety at home, click in the upper right corner for a guided cognitive behavioral technique that relaxes your body and, as a result, your mind. Anxiety is no joke. If you think that you, a friend, or a family member is suffering from an anxiety disorder, take a look in the description for more resources in your area. Help is out there, and you're not alone, so don't wait. Thanks for watching this episode of Micah Psych. If you like this episode, give me a thumbs up and hit subscribe if you'd like to catch more videos about brain diseases and disorders in the future. Make sure you head over and check out Allie's video about the neuroscience of anxiety. If you love us as much as we love you, consider supporting us on Patreon. We really couldn't do all of this without your support, and we really appreciate it. Tweet me if you want to talk about anxiety or treatment or therapy, and if you'd like to learn about a particular condition, let us know in the comments below. Until next time, I'm Micah. Think about it.